Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, how are you? Maybe take a minute to say hi to your neighbor, someone who's next to you, or cross the aisle and say hi to someone as you begin. It's okay to stand. Great. We'll begin with our meditation from Psalms chapter 3, and I will read it. Lord, how many are my foes? Many rise up against me, and many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you, O Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high. I call to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep, I wake up again, because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw and break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be upon your people. So even as we begin with a song which is based off this psalm, I pray that you will find solace and comfort in the Lord, who is our sustainer despite everything we go through.
Oh,
out to the Lord and he answers us from his holy hill. Amen. Help us put your hands together as we sing this song. All things are possible through Christ who gives us strength. Amen.
Possible in our God. Amen. Through Jesus Christ. Put your hands together as we give him praise, for he's a good God. Hakuna Mungu kama Baba. Hallelujah. Shangwe kwa Yesu. Hallelujah. It's a simple song. We've sung it before, but I hope you can follow through. Amen. Hakuna, hakuna, hakuna Mungu kama wewe Baba.
Hakuna, hakuna, hakuna Mungu kama wewe Baba.
Hakuna mwingine kama wewe Baba.
Hakuna, hakuna, hakuna Mungu kama wewe Baba.
Hakuna, hakuna, hakuna kimbilio la tu wewe.
Hakuna, hakuna, hakuna Mungu kama wewe Baba.
Hakuna mwingine kama wewe Baba. Come on, let's dance for the Lord. Shefu wa mataifa yote. Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni mfalme wa mataifa yote. Mungu ni mfalme wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni mfalme
wa mataifa yote.
Mungu ni mfalme. Come on, dance for Jesus. Wondering what shefu means. Shefu just means boss, okay? Let's sing that again. Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa yote. Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa yote. Mungu ni shefu wa mataifa
yote.
Mungu ni mfalme wa mataifa yote. Mungu ni mfalme wa mataifa
yote.
Come on, clap for Jesus. Alitenda mambo makubwa, shetani akashangaa sema. How many believe that our God tenders? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So we will just sing this simple thing. When I say, Baba tender, you say?
Tender.
Amen. Do you believe he can do it? Let's try and we sing along. Mungu tender. Baba tender. Oh.
Tender, Baba tender.
Mungu wa amani tender.
Tender, Baba tender.
Yo, 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 yo. You're doing so good. Oh, yo, yo, yo. Alisema atatenda, wanadamu wakashangaa tenda.
Tenda, tenda, tenda.
Hallelujah, give him praise for he is worthy. And we're not done yet. We're going to bless the name of our Lord as we say Atawale. Hallelujah. Atawale, wachie Yesu. This one is familiar. Come on, let's sing to the Lord.
Atawale, atawale, wachie Yesu. Atawale.
Oh, atawale, atawale, wachie Yesu. Baba atawale. The glory is yours. Come and reign, Lord.
Come and reign, Lord. Come and reign. For the glory is yours. Come,
come on, declare that. Come and reign, Lord. Come and reign. For the glory is yours. Come and reign, Lord.
Come and reign, Lord. Come and reign. For the glory is yours. Come and reign.
Oh, Atawale. Atawale, wachie Yesu, Baba Atawale.
Atawale, Atawale, wachie Yesu,
atawale mwachie Yesu, atawale maishani mwetu. Put your hands in the air, Mungwa uzima, Mungwa amani, Mungwa ushindi, Mungwa uzima, Mungwa baraka. Amen. He's a good God. How many believe He is a good God? Amen. We've tasted and we've seen that the Lord, He is good and His mercies endureth forever. And the words from Psalm 89 proclaim of this great God, that the heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He's more awesome than all who surround him. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Amen. And imagine this great God. He created us in his image, in his likeness. He, the uncreated, created us in his image, and he cares so much for us. Romans 8 reminds us that he gave up everything. He gave up his own son, isn't it? And why wouldn't he graciously give us all things? And I don't know whether you're here wondering, okay, my life is not going the way I expected it to go. I prayed, I have cried out. This great God, this great I am, is concerned about our lives. Hallelujah. And even as we sing the words of this song, may you be confident, have faith in him, that he will not pass you by. He hears your cry. He hears your prayer. And he's willing to meet you at your point of need. So may we be blessed as we sing this song to our Lord. And if you're in need, cry out to him, Savior, Savior, hear my cry. Savior, do not pass me by. Savior, while you're blessing others, please remember me. Amen. Let's sing together. Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
Hear my humble cry. Let's sing the second verse. Let me at the throne of mercy.
Let me at the throne of mercy
find a sweet relief.
A sweet relief.
Kneeling there. voices and say, oh, words of the third verse.
This morning, do not pass us by. We come before you because we want to have a connection with you. As that song is being sung, Lord, we almost don't want to stop singing it because we are acutely aware of the fact that being in your presence is a wonderful thing. No wonder Peter and John, when they have the experience of seeing you transfigured on top of the mountain, they wanted to linger there a little bit longer. And so, Lord, we want to be able to linger even in this space a little bit longer, acutely aware of your presence among us and you watching over us and taking care of us and being with us. And why are we able to do this? It's because of some very powerful words that the Apostle Paul records for us. In Romans chapter 3 from verse 21, the Bible says, "But now the righteousness of God has been made manifest apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He passed over former sins. It was to show His righteousness at the present time, so that He might be the just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus." So if you have faith in Jesus, you can be able to know this one thing: God is ready to justify you and to look at you as if you have never sinned. And that is the beauty of us being able to come at this moment. It's all so beautiful and wonderful. Let us quieten our hearts even as we pray this prayer. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer be able to bear, and what sometimes to us has become a consuming fire of judgment. Would you, my Father and my God, set us free from a past that we cannot change and open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant to us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. For we ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We are about to share the Lord's table. And in the process of being able to share the Lord's table, it's always a moment to be able to quieten our spirits and to be able to, you know, just do some business with God. Be able to come before Him and know that He is ready to forgive you. So you don't need to feel like you need to be able to come with certain words or in a certain way. Sometimes even just a whisper. And so the worship team is going to be singing that song all over again. But at this moment, may I ask us to be able to just take our seats at this moment. And as it is a tradition, I usually say, forgetting about the person to your right and to your left. This is just a quiet moment. You may bow your head, you may look up. It doesn't matter what you do. But there's a moment to be able to just be able to say, "Yes, Lord, do not pass me by. I promise this year to stop certain things. It's February and I seem to have already fallen into what I ought not to have done. I promise to be maybe more forgiving this year. But already I sense a deep sense of unforgiveness in my heart. I promise maybe to be to drop certain relationships. But I still find myself in those relationships. Savior, do not pass me by. It is me."
Savior, won't you hear my humble cry? While on others Thou art calling, do not pass me by. And we say,
that is the prayer that we have in our hearts even at this moment. Do not pass us by. I'd like to invite those who are going to be distributing the elements to please come. It is a worshipful moment for all of us. And as we do this, I want to ask you to please hold on to the elements so that you can be able to share them together. Here at Mamlaka Hill Chapel, we serve an open table. What does that mean? It is open to any person who truly knows that they have a relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their lives. So once you get these elements, please hold on to them. And if you have been able to pray and to know that the Lord has forgiven you, please feel free. Do not let the devil remind you of guilt in any way, but freely receive. Because the reasons why we celebrate the Lord's table is to be reminded constantly of God's goodness to us and what God has done in our lives in order for us to be able to experience this freedom that is very, very critical in our lives.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond the measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
See you.
Apostle Paul in the book of 1 Corinthians says these words. Our Lord, in the night when he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, and then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And today we each have received a piece of bread, which is representative of a much bigger one, which was broken into little pieces. And it represents the breaking of Christ's body for us. As a church, we have started the year on quite a difficult note. I think we have had quite a number of funerals already. A number of visitations to hospital. That just happens to be the vicissitudes of leaving this world. But the beauty of it all is that Christ's body was broken for us. And that is always something beautiful. And that's why we do this all the time. Friends, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Take, eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Let's take the bread together. In the same way, after supper, Jesus Christ took a cup. And after he had given thanks, he said, "Drink this, for this is the sign of the new covenant written in my blood." And what is our biggest problem as humanity? It is a problem of sin. But the beauty of it all is that Christ's blood washes away all sin. So regardless of the challenges that we may face, the best thing that ever happens to us is to know that our sins are forgiven. Friends, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for you. Preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Let us share in the cup together. Shall we pray? As our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Father and our God, we have come before you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for these elements which powerfully remind us of what you did for us. The breaking of your body and the shedding of your blood for our sake. So regardless of where we may be, Jehovah God, this morning, we thank you because we are constantly reminded of just how much you've done for us in order for us to be able to experience redemption. Thank you for leaving behind these elements for us. To be constantly reminded, even when things don't seem to work out, you have still been able to deal with our biggest challenge. So be there a parent here who does not know what to do with their child. Be there a marriage here which is struggling. Be it a person with a relative, or maybe they're not feeling very well, or maybe a place of work or a business. Regardless of what is happening in our lives, oh Lord, we know that all is well because you've dealt with the biggest problem that you could ever face. And that is the problem of sin. We bless you, Lord, and we glorify your name. For it is in Jesus' name we do pray and believe. Amen and amen. Please pass the cups, the end of the aisles, please, so I can be able to collect them. And thank you so much. May I ask us to also just appreciate the worship team for serving and leading us so well today. Thank you. Thank you very much. As that is happening, I want to be able to say thank you, karibuni sana, to this, our second service here at Mamlaka Hill Chapel. We had another service at 10 o'clock and also another one at this moment. And also it gives me great, great pleasure to be able to invite and to be able to welcome all of you who are joining us via live stream. It's always a pleasure to be able to have you stream this service. And just to be able to tell you that karibuni to Mamlaka Hill Chapel, it's always good to be able to know and to find out where you are coming from. So please feel free to be able to comment on the comment site. But more than that, go ahead and subscribe to this channel. And also, please be careful to mark on the little bell so that you can be able to get updates on some of our ministry activities here at Mamlaka Hill Chapel. And just be able to say that for the rest of us, our YouTube channel is fantastic. One of the things that we are doing now is we are doing what we call covers. I have come to discover in the recent past that a cover is not a cover for a book, but a cover is when you sing somebody else's song. It's a cover. Oh, so now I know. And it's good to be able to see that that's one of the few things that we are doing. So do visit our YouTube channel, subscribe to it so it can actually be able to receive quite a bit of our messages. Last week, Pastor Charles was able to look at the life of Moses and some of the questions that he had, matters of sadness, matters of anger, and a couple of unresolved issues in his life. And today we get to go on and look at something else that is very important, and that is the whole area of his calling and his ministry and how he ends up becoming one of the greatest leaders that is recorded in the Bible. But before I go too far, some of you may be wondering, who is this that is talking to you? My name is Isaac, pastor for adults here at Mamlaka Hill Chapel. And on behalf of Mamlaka, I'd like to be able to welcome you to this service. And more than that, please do something for me. Go ahead and welcome somebody that you probably did not come with. Reach out to somebody and tell them, karibu sana. Ramson. Good to be able to say to welcome. I know sometimes it's one of those things somebody actually the other day had a bit of some challenges with. It was on Twitter where they said whenever their most uncomfortable moment is when preachers say extend a hand of fellowship to somebody. But I want to be able to say that Christianity at the end of the day is a community. It is not something that we do alone. We do together as a community. So at this moment also, we know that there could be members of our community who do not really come here. These are probably our visitors. May I please ask us to be able, if you're a visitor, please put up your hand. We'd like people to appreciate your presence at this moment. Aha, we have visitors. Oh, wow. Lots and lots of hands going round. Let me ask us to do something even more brave. Please do stand. If you are a visitor, I'd like you to ask you to please stand at this moment. Thank you. Thank you very much. Oh, wow. Thank you. Karibuni sana. We love visitors. And if you're looking for a faith community, please feel free to be able to come here on a regular basis. And just in case you are passing through and you're going back to your faith community, please do take back our greetings with you. But do not be in a hurry at the end of the service. PG is here, and at the end of the service, I'd like to ask you to please come, and he will escort you to our visitor's lounge, where you're going to have a little bit of some time together. But at this moment, I also want to be able to appreciate, thanks PG, I want to appreciate the presence of a very important visitor. Sometimes on a regular basis, our community expands by virtue of growth in terms of birth. And there is a visitor today who has come not of his own accord, but he has been brought by his parents for the very first time. Steve Rigby and your wife, please do stand and introduce the little one. Tell us who he is and, first time at Mamlaka Hill Chapel.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Yes, I'm Stephen. This is Karis, my wife, and Abigail, yes. Our little girl. And we have Owen Paul Rigby, who is here with us for the first time.
Yes.
So we're excited to be here. He was born 4 weeks ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Asante sana. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And may this child bring great joy to all of you. Abigail, I think you're going to be a preacher in the future. Yes, holding on to the mic very hard. Thank you. Asante sana. Let us appreciate our visitors one more time. Yes, at this moment, we want to be able to find out what's happening in our community. Let's have our news.
Jambo, and welcome to Mamlaka Hill Chapel. Our vision is to be empowered to transform lives, society, and this world. And our mission is to promote personal intimacy with God in order to build godly communities that will impact this nation and the rest of the nations for Christ. Do you find it challenging to share the gospel with people? Do you sometimes wonder how to even begin sharing about your love for Christ with people from different cultures of faith? Well, we've got you covered. Dr. Yulisa Rowe, in conjunction with our missions department, have put together a 5-class seminar on cross-cultural witnessing. These classes are ideal for all professionals, university students, or Christians interested in equipping themselves to succeed as salt and light in the world. The classes will be held every Thursday, beginning the 21st of February to the 28th of March 2019 from 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. Don't miss this wonderful opportunity. Sign up today at the info desk. God has called us to make us disciples of all nations and to be His witnesses to the ends of this earth. 2,000 years after Jesus gave the command, there are people who have not even heard the gospel. The question is, do we have to send people thousands of miles away, far from home and family for this? Is there no one from among them who can do this? Mamlaka Missions invites you to this year's Go Tell Conference from the 25th to the 27th of April 2019 at Mamlaka Hill Chapel, Ruaka, from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. in the evening. Charges are only 3,700 Kenya shillings for early birds before 31st of March 2019 and a further 4,000 Kenya shillings afterwards. Reverse missions, returning the favor, is the theme, and the aim of the conference is on mobilizing the church in Africa to make a stronger commitment for global missions. For more information, kindly send an email to missions@mamlakahillchapel.org or leave your details at the information desk and we'll be sure to get back to you. And I will say this one more time. For more information, write to missions@mamlakahillchapel.org. I'm sure you got that one right. Ladies and gentlemen, those were your announcements for this week. Let us continue in worship.
Right, no wedding bands today. So at this moment, we are going to worship the Lord through giving. And just be able to reiterate that as a sign of the times, we have different modes and methods of being able to give. And obviously, they will be displayed. But just in case you're writing a check, please remember to write Mamlaka Hill Chapel. And the pay bill and the account number will be beamed immediately. But at this moment, may I please invite our ushers, please do come. We want to pray so that we can be able to get to a time of being able to give. Thank you so much for serving us and for being there for us constantly and helping us out. Asanteni sana. Let us pray. Father, we are very, very grateful for giving us an opportunity to be able to give. We do not give because you are unable, but because it is a privilege given to us so that we can be able to be used by you to further the kingdom of God. We pray, my Father and my God, for these resources that your people are about to give, that they will be used to serve the kingdom of God, to push forward the gospel and to push back the darkness. We thank you also for our ushers who are representative of many other people who serve us diligently here as a faith community. Be honored, be glorified, and be exalted. For it is in Jesus' name we do pray and believe. Amen.
Praise God. The Lord is good, and all the time. We're going to sing Bless You with this song. I pray that it really blesses you. It's an anthem for some of us here who have gone through hard times. And, you know, the realization that after all has been said and done, the Lord holds our world in His hands. Amen? And so I pray that you put your trust in Him. Do not give up on Him, because He is a good God.
Let go of me. No, no.
pray someone believes that today, man.
Thank you. Thank you very much. At this moment, I would like to say somebody, well, it's always good to take advantage whenever he's around, our chairman for the Elder Scott. Please do come, greet us, and then invite Pastor Charles and pray for him. Tafadhali. Yes.
Thank you. Good morning, Mamlaka. Good morning once again. Yes, my name is Kivadi, for those who do not know me, and I'm happy to be here this morning. Usually fellowship in different areas, either in the other, in Roka campus or here in the main city, but I'm happy to be with each and every one of you this morning. Let me just invite Pastor Charles so we can start the service. And greetings from Roka.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay, let's pray. Dearly Father, we just want to come before you this morning, thanking you so much for such a lovely, lovely morning. We thank you that, Father, that there are signs that the rain is about to come. We pray that, Father, as the rain is coming, that today's message will also be raining on our hearts and lives, that, Father, it will be a life-changing message, that each one of us will be met at their point of need. So, Father, we present Pastor Charles before you, that, Father, he will diminish and you increase, and we'll hear clearly from you. In Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, church. Bwana sifiwe. Praise the Lord. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Elder Kivadi, for praying for me. And Pastor Isaac, thank you for leading us through communion, reminding us of the price that was paid by Christ, so that we could be called his own. Sharing in the bread and in the cup is always a sobering reminder of why we are called the body of Christ, broken for us, and the price that Jesus paid to make us his own. We pray that we will never take that for granted, that we will always be thankful in our hearts when we meet like we do, and have our identity in Jesus Christ. Amen. Our visitors, thank you for choosing to come and worship with us at Mamlaka Hill Chapel. It always warms our hearts to know that of the many places you could have chosen, you came here. And so thank you. Thank you. Well, last week, we explored from the life of Moses what we call the dynamics of identity and calling, and examined how Moses' own experience, his background, how that could have affected the way he would respond later on to the call of God on his life. A few surprising things that happened. We saw him emerge from the palace of Pharaoh, step out into the environment that was really harsh, an environment of cruelty and bondage and oppression. And the first instinct is that Moses lashes out in anger at the first encounter with his with injustice, close, he lashes out with anger and violence, and he ends up murdering an Egyptian and burying him in the sand. He's on a roll. The very following day, finds two Hebrews quarreling. He intervenes, and he's about to sort things out when he's called out for what he had done. And out of fear of the crime that he had committed, he begins a long flight to Midian. But even there, he's not at peace, because he sits by a well. Seven lovely girls come, the daughters of Jethro. They want to water the flock of their father. And shepherds come out from nowhere and start bullying the girls. Again, Moses stands up to them and is able to be... he takes a stand, scares them off, feeds the flock, and at the end of the day, he ends up in Midian at Jethro's house, marries Zipporah, the firstborn daughter, and settles there in Midian. And part of what we were exploring were the emotions of Moses, the things that made him so angry that he was willing and ready to lash out and even to kill, and how being in touch with who we are, our emotional health, how that affects our spiritual progress, our spiritual maturity, eventually even our call in this faith. We will continue with that story and maybe ask some more questions about who we are as reflected in the life of Moses, and maybe even explore further God's call on our lives, what we are doing about it, and what might be hindering our spiritual progress as far as that call is concerned. We will be in the book of Exodus, chapter 3, as we continue that story. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out before because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. So the story so far. Many years have passed. Moses fled to Midian, settled there, married. This is 40 years later. We first met him when he was aged 40, stepping out to try and confront his world. And then he messed up and had to run away as a fugitive. Goes, settles in Midian. And even though for the Bible it's just the next sentence, 40 years have passed. So this is a different Moses. He was 40 years old then, now he's an 80-year-old man. Probably more settled. I don't know what has happened to him in his life so far, but it's quite a contrast from the Moses that we met. The very opening sentence, Moses was tending the sheep of his father, Jethro. The last time we encountered him, he was a powerful prince of Egypt, a man of means. In Acts chapter 7, from verse 20, Stephen is giving a commentary on Israel, and he talks about Moses, the special child, and he says of Moses that Moses was educated in all the knowledge and the wisdom of the Egyptians. And he was powerful in deed and in word, in speech and in action. That's the Moses that we last met. But here, he's a much mellowed man who's just a shepherd. If an Egyptian journalist had followed the life of Moses and tracked with him from Ramesses to Midian, I don't know how the headlines of the Egyptian Times would have read. How the mighty have fallen. Or from grace to grass. You know those catchy things that they like saying, you know? The once powerful prince of Egypt who wielded power is now languishing in the deserts of Midian, a mere shepherd boy. And one can only imagine, what did that do to the person of Moses? What did he think about himself? Was he imagining that, were these just illusions of grandeur that I had? Because once I actually did believe I was the deliverer. You know, the stories had made their way that there was this special child who was saved miraculously, brought up in Pharaoh's court, and somehow preserved when all the other kids were being killed. Why? Because God had a special mission for him. But now, 40 years down the road, does he even believe he has a mission to fulfill on earth? Or was this just a really, really bad mistake? I don't know what he must have been thinking about. Maybe he blamed himself. If only I hadn't killed that Egyptian. If only I hadn't tried to intervene. If only I'd waited. I don't know what he was thinking. But for many of us, you attempt to do something believing that you're doing it for God. Maybe you didn't ask God, but you did it anyway. And then it goes terribly wrong. And things really look like they have turned against you. And now you don't even believe that you have a mission to accomplish anymore. Neither do the people around you. They don't affirm you. They even remind you of your past failures. And for many of us, we live in this shadow, under this cloud of doubt, and sometimes even shame. And we believe we have nothing useful to contribute to the kingdom of God. But the remarkable and the beautiful thing about the burning bush encounter is not so much that Moses has this amazing conversation with God. It's just that, you see, Moses wasn't looking for God in Midian. He was just surviving. He ran. He was a fugitive. He was looking to restart his life all over, far away from the place of his defeat, from Egypt. The amazing thing is that God goes looking for Moses in the desert. And when God finds Moses, he decides to reveal himself in an enticing, intriguing, even beautiful way. There's a burning bush, and he's not getting consumed. It's an intriguing sight, and God is using this technique because he doesn't want to intimidate Moses. He's gentle. Whenever God appears, or even an angel of the Lord, it's usually overwhelming. When the angel of the Lord appeared to the shepherds to announce the birth of the Messiah, you know, the glory shone around and everybody was scared. And they have to say, do not be afraid, for I bring good news. But in this instance, it's a private encounter. God has this customized apparition. He comes in a very private way. He customizes his appearance to Moses, and he has a very intimate conversation with him. And the Bible says that when God saw that Moses had stopped and turned to look, so he had Moses' attention. It's a private audience. Then God calls from inside the burning bush, and he calls him by name, Moses, Moses. How refreshing must that have been to be called by God? Again, a very private audience. Moses responds, here I am. And then God begins a conversation that will begin a new relationship between God and Moses. Moses, before you come any further, let me tell you what we're going to do. Take off your shoes. Because the ground you're standing on is holy ground. Now, I'm sure Moses had walked that desert many times and he knew this wasn't holy ground. It was just grazing ground, you know? But God says, there's a new relationship that I'm beginning here with you. Take off your sandals. The ground you're standing on is holy ground because I inhabit that ground. And once I appear, then I hallow the ground on which you stand. Where you encounter me, that is your holy ground. And then we'll have a conversation with you. This must have been very refreshing, very affirming to Moses, who probably hadn't had any voice, anyone call him out, an authority figure, like it used to be back in Egypt. But now God comes and calls him. And now a new relationship will begin to develop between Moses and God. And then God reveals himself to Moses. Not only that, I mean, God is saying, Moses, I know you. I know, you know, you don't think anybody cares about you anymore or knows where you are, but my eyes have been on you all these 40 years. And now I've called you by name. And if anybody called you by name, it doesn't matter if they're a stranger, even if you've never seen them before, and they come and call you by name. Hey, Mike, you will turn first of all, then you realize, how do you know me? It's an establishment of a connection. And this is what God wants to do with Moses. This is what God wants to do with us. He's not generic. He doesn't come and address us generally, oh ye people. You know, who is oh ye people? I'm not oh ye people. You want to hear your name, Jane, called out. Oh, Mike. And this is the nature of God. Because what he'll tell you is customized for you. And he's saying, I know you. I know where you live. I know why you're here. I know what you're going through. I know your challenges. I know your difficulties. I even know your fear. And I'm here to address that. That's how God talks to us. And then God reveals himself. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, your forefathers. So I'm not a different God. And immediately, Moses establishes a connection. He knows who this is. And he's like, okay, God, you are here, and you still remember me? And immediately, God discloses who he is. Moses hides his face because he was afraid to look at God. And then God reiterates the mission. Moses, I don't just know you by name. I know why you're here. And I've come for you. Because you and I have a mission to accomplish. Remember Egypt? Remember those feelings you had that day when you killed that Egyptian? Well, I have indeed seen the suffering of my people, Israel. I have heard their cry for help, and I am concerned about their suffering. Therefore, I have come. I have come to rescue them. So this is what we're going to do, Moses. I am sending you. I choose you. Go. Tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Let my people go. And you can only imagine the flood of emotions that must have come over Moses. Just the mention of the suffering of the people of Israel, which he felt strong enough to kill for. But this is 40 years later. God, why are you here? Why didn't you use me then? Well, that wasn't the time, Moses. I was waiting for you to settle down and know that this is actually my mission, not your mission. And that I want to use you as an instrument in my hands, not to carry out your agenda of revenge against the Egyptians, but my purpose for the people of Israel. So now I have come. This is the time. Now go. Tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses will have this discourse with God. Again, a private audience. Nobody even knows it's happening. It's in Midian on the back of beyond. And God, this is his nature. He comes to many of us in private. And he calls you by name. And he says, you know, I'm interested in you. I want to use you. You know, Moses, because he was wired for freedom, he was wired for justice. That's why God chose him to lead that great freedom movement, the Exodus, the greatest freedom movement in all history. And those things, the feelings that Moses had strong inside his soul, you know, were not actually there by accident. God put them there because he intended to use him to lead his people into freedom. And sometimes we feel strongly about things and we think, oh, this is just me. No, it's not just you. God wired you that way for a reason. And for some of us, you know, when you see the young people going astray, you see them in addictions of all kinds, doing drugs and sex and all kinds of things to dull their pain and lack of direction, something in you wakes up and says, this is not right. Somebody needs to give these young people direction and parameters. Somebody needs to mentor them and to let them know that, you know, life is can be better than what it is right now. So the call of God hasn't changed. And God still uses real people who he calls by name and gives a real mission to go and set his people free. And God's people are still in captivity even today. Thousands are languishing in fear outside the knowledge of God, in all kinds of addictions. And God is saying, hey, I want to use you. Go and tell my people, I have come to set them free. The promise of Isaiah 61 hasn't changed. Jesus said, I have come to preach good news to the poor. The poor are those who are languishing in all kinds of distractions by the enemy. I have come to bind up the brokenhearted. That's why I put a heart of compassion in you. That when you see somebody in suffering, something inside you just cries out and you want to reach out and comfort them and tell them it will be okay and speak a word of encouragement to them. That's your call. God is saying, that's how I've wired you and I want to use you that way to bring comfort to my people. To bind up the brokenhearted. To set the captives free. And so Moses will have this conversation ongoing with God and God will continue to reveal himself again and again and again. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals for the place where you're standing is holy ground. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. Verse 10, so now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh, to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Who am I? This is a different Moses. The self-confidence is gone. You know, he's no longer just, I mean, when he was killing the Egyptian, he wasn't asking that question, who am I? He knew who he was and he knew what he could do. But now God asks, you know, you go. He says, who am I? Who am I? And the true answer to that question is that Moses, you're actually nobody. That is the accurate position. But guess what? I will be with you. I will be with you. You will go as my representative. You no longer represent yourself. You represent the interest of the kingdom of God, of the King of Kings, of the Lord of Lords. So you go and speak on my behalf, and I will give you power and courage to be able to do that. When you speak, I speak. You go. I will be with you. And this will be a sign that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out, not if, when you have brought. So the people will be set free. When you bring them out, you will worship me on this mountain. Meaning you'll be a free people, Moses. That's the dream. Isn't that what you wanted? You wanted freedom for your people? This is your chance. I will use you as an instrument in my hands to accomplish that dream that you had 40 years ago. But now it's going to happen in real time, but in my terms. It's my agenda, not yours, Moses. So Moses begins to give many reasons. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Isaac, Abraham, and the God of Isaac, the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I'm to be remembered from generation to generation. Then God gives him the instructions of how the plan is to work out. Moses wants to know, what's your name and what's the plan? So this is the plan. Go assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you up out of that misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. So that's a heads up, Moses. Don't be discouraged. They'll actually believe you. They will listen to you. Then you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a three-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. So Moses, you have doubts? Let me give you the results ahead of time. This is how it will work out, all right? The elders will believe you. You will go to Pharaoh. He will not believe you, but I'll stretch out my hand. I'll strike him. Then he will let you go. That's how this plays out. That's the plan, Moses. So go. So God goes on to give Moses more and more revelation. And at some point, Moses is genuinely seeking to know, how will this work out? But at one point, you realize he's no longer wanting to understand the plan. He's now dealing with his personal fears and a resistance to be sent by God and to be used by God. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? A staff, he said. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground and it became a snake and he ran from it. So it was a real snake. This is not fake news. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake and it turned back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has appeared to you. So he's revealing himself as the creator God. And remember, Moses is familiar with the ways of the Egyptians. Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, would wear his headdress, which had a cobra, you know, a bronze cobra just at the crown here. And that was his sign of sovereignty and power. And so God was saying, you know, I know what you think. Now, how about you have the real power to create this snake and then to turn it back into a staff as a sign of power and sovereignty? So you do this, then they will know who really is in charge here. Then the Lord said, put your hand into your cloak. So Moses put his hand into his cloak, and when he took it out, it was leprous like snow. Again, leprosy, that was a frightful disease, skin disease, contagious and without a cure in those days. And so God wants to demonstrate his power. I'm able to heal. I'm able to cause disease. I'm able to destroy. I'm able to reform. Now put it back into your cloak, he said. So Moses put his hand back into his cloak. And when he took it out, he was restored like the rest of his flesh. So God wants to demonstrate. Moses, I got your back. Don't worry. You know, with me on your side, you don't have to fear Pharaoh. You know, you actually are the one with the power, not Pharaoh anymore. So go with the confidence that I have sent you and that you have my full backing, my full endorsement, and my full power. Then the Lord said, if they do not believe you or pay attention to the first miraculous sign, they may believe the second. So Moses, this is plan A, this is plan B. But guess what? I'll even give you plan C. But if they do not believe that these two signs or listen to you, take some water from the Nile and pour it on the ground. The water you take from the river will become blood on the ground. Again, blood is a sign of life. So I'm the life giver here, and I can withdraw it if I so wish. Moses said to the Lord, O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. So at this point, we know we are not just dealing with a lack of information about the power or the ability of God. Moses has reverted to a different mode of giving excuses, and really the plan is, I don't plan to get on board this ship with the Lord. So let me bring all the excuses that I have so that I will not be the one to go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. So Moses is clearly dealing with past fears. He cannot imagine himself going back to Egypt. And despite these huge and powerful and amazing signs, despite a private audience with God, despite a personal calling, God called him by name. Moses gives excuse after excuse after excuse. Again, not very different from many of us. He's acting like an unbeliever here, right? And he's okay to come and examine the burning bush, you know. It's a curious sight. He comes, you know, like sometimes you'll come to church, you know. It's intriguing, some of the stories the pastors give. You know, you check them out, they sound interesting, even amusing, you know. But when God asks you to board, when he calls you by name and saying, hey, look, this is not even about what's going on. It's about me and you. I know you by name. I know where you're coming from. I know your failures, your past fears, all your issues. I know them. But you know what? We are going to work something out, you and I. And I won't bring up the past. God never brings up the murder of that Egyptian. Never accuses Moses about that. He says, somehow, I'll weave all that into the calling that I have given you. But this time, instead of you acting in your own will, I will direct your actions into my will and purpose so that we can achieve something for my kingdom. And there are many of us who walk through this life having received the call of God to submit to his lordship and to his direction and to his salvation, and we sit there and we resist. Every time we are asked, you know, the Lord is calling you. He's interested in your life. He wants to save you. He has a rescue plan. Not just for you, by the way. Because it's way about, the kingdom of God is way about you. Right? We come and hear so that we can go tell. God wants to use us as instruments in his hand so that the many who are in bondage and slavery can be set free through your agency. But you never even respond to your own call to salvation. And therefore, in this amazing race that God has called us, that ends in eternity with him, with glory, and with victory, we never even get to the start line. You never even register for the race. So there's little God can do. There's little God can do. The least you can do is register for the race. Whether or not you win, that's a non-issue. God is saying, you know, I will energize you. I will give you power. I will ensure that you've reached the finish line. In fact, you'll all be winners. And you will reach the end because it won't depend on you. It will depend on me. I'll be your personal coach. I will be with you. I will train you. I'll teach you what to do. But you don't even register for the race. This is what Moses is doing. And God is like, hey, Moses, look, I've given you sign after sign after sign that I'm able. I will empower you. Pharaoh is a non-issue here. I am there with you. So when you tell him, let my people go, he will refuse. That's okay. But I will compel him. And when I do, then he will let you go. And you will worship me on this mountain. So look beyond yourself, Moses. Look beyond your personal fears. Look beyond your insecurities. Look beyond your personal identity issues. Look beyond your anger and whatever it is that is keeping you. And think about those people that I want to rescue through you. And stop being selfish. Now, you can tell God is upset by the way he responds to Moses. He says, I've never been eloquent and so on and so forth. The Lord said to him, who gave man his mouth? You know when God becomes that basic, you don't know what to respond. Who gave man his mouth? Who makes him deaf or mute? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go. Stop giving excuses. I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. I'll be your personal coach. Moses' amazing response, oh Lord, please send someone else. Here I am, send him. Simple mathematics. That's what many of us do. Here I am, send her. And my simple question to you is, what are the excuses that you keep giving? First of all, for never coming into the kingdom of God, when we commemorate the Lord's table, this is my body broken for you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Drink this as often as you take it in remembrance of me. Number one, that I was broken so that you could become part of my body. You could remain united. And by my wounds, you have been healed. Secondly, the blood of the new covenant, I shed this blood for you for the forgiveness of your sins. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. This is what God says. So what's your excuse for not entering into the kingdom? I'm not asking you to pay for your salvation. I already did that, Jesus says. Your blood can never pay for anything, but I shed my blood so that you don't have to shed yours. Salvation, free of charge, but at an incredible price to him. What keeps you from accepting Christ as Lord and Savior? A simple walk of faith and saying, Christ, thank you for the price that you paid. I receive your gift free of charge. Your life given for mine in Jesus' name. As simple as that. And you can become part of the kingdom. If you are part of the kingdom of God, but haven't been in touch with your purpose and the reason God created you, and you sit here Sunday after Sunday, while countless people are in dire need of the gifts that God has given you free of charge to serve his people, to give them the good news, to tell them that the creator of the universe has paid an incredible price for their freedom. Maybe you've even struggled like Moses with your own personal identity. There are many struggling with identity issues. Maybe you struggle with anger like Moses did, but God has spoken to you and somehow you are relatively calm and normal now. Maybe there's somebody waiting to be told, show me the baby steps. How do I come to a place where, you know, I can glorify God through my speech, through my words, through the things that I say, and it's no longer about me, it's about the kingdom of God? How can I mentor somebody and walk them the baby steps that I walked years ago so that they know that they too can have hope, so that they can know that there is freedom from drug addiction, from alcoholism, from pornography? God never wastes even your worst experiences. He never wasted even Moses' murder. He used that as a way of redeeming him and redeeming the Israelites from violence and anger and murder. Maybe that was your story. You were that addict, but God saved you. But now you've privatized this. You don't even talk about it. And God is saying, hey, I did this for a purpose. I have many still in captivity, and I need them set free. Tell them what I did for you so that they too can have the confidence of walking out of that relationship that doesn't glorify me, out of that addiction. Tell them about it. My question, what excuses are you giving to God for not engaging? What are the giftings that are unique to you that you know this is what I would do even if I wasn't paid because this is who I am? And how are you using those to glorify God? By proclaiming the good news to many who are held in bondage and captivity, so that the kingdom of God may be established and glory and honor may return to him. And you yourself, you will be greatly blessed as a result. And don't be like Moses, giving excuse after excuse, even though God has given you abundant evidence that he's not only able to set you free, but he has the power to set many others free. May God convict us in the places of our calling, that we may advance from our fears and our insecurities. And once God has revealed his power to us, called us by name, customized a meeting with us in privacy, whispering, you know, I love you, I care for you, I saved you. Now I need you to go and tell others because I came to heal the brokenhearted, to set the captives free, to proclaim freedom for God's people, to declare the year of the Lord's favor. That's you and I saying that. This is what we are called for. May the Lord convict you, and may the Lord encourage you to say yes to him, because in each of us, there is a great freedom movement waiting to happen for God's people if only we would present ourselves as instruments of grace to be used in the hands of a mighty God for whom nothing is impossible. The Lord bless you.
Thank you. I think just before we have the benediction, I'd like to ask PG if you can be able to join me. Visitors, please do not be in a hurry to leave. And at this moment, in case you want to be able to pray a little bit longer, we do have a prayer room. It is to my right, just behind the info desk. There are prayer counselors waiting to pray with you. But at this moment, please let us rise for the benediction. Almighty God, eternal Father, we have sat at your feet, learned from your word, and eaten from your table. We give you thanks and praise for accepting us into your family. Send us out with your blessing to live and to witness for you in the power of the Holy Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, the firstborn from the dead. Amen. Shall we share in the words of the grace together? And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you now and forevermore. Amen.